Alright, welcome back to Steve's Model Builds, and we've got a bit of a treat today. You may have seen a previous video where I picked this kit up along with three others. This was $4.99 Canadian from the my local hobby shop's bargain bin. So cheap as you can get. The kit itself, the box was from 1983. And the original tooling was 1979. It is an actual Matchbox kit. You have to watch out because a lot of companies, you know, they licensed out their name and so forth and had someone else manufacture it. Revell and Matchbox, they had a relationship. You can always go on ScaleMates and find out which is which. If you're thinking about getting a model kit, I'd go to ScaleMates. They show a timeline when there was new tooling, the original tooling, new box, and so on and so forth. So that's a great resource. That's ScaleMates.com. All right, so here we go. The Spitfire, the 148 Tamiya Spitfire is coming. That's a big build, and it's also probably for on a scale of 5, probably at least a 3 as far as the skill level is concerned. Certainly a 4 if you're going to paint it up and so forth. So that's going to take a number of different chapters. But today we're going to do this kit. $4.99 Canadian, like I said, at the local hobby shop. And it's a 1/72 scale. I should also apologize for background noise. We live beside a country road, which all the young guns think it's pretty hilarious to drive their firecracker cars and motorcycles and everything up and down at high speed, making lots of noise. So I apologize if we get interrupted by blarting sounds or loud motorcycles. Okay, so we've got the kit here. I'm not going to do a full review on the kit with the rating scale, mostly because it's an old kit. Not really fair. Also, it's a pretty small kit. But we'll go over things briefly here. It is a genuine Matchbox kit. They're not available anymore. Matchbox got out of the plastic model business years and years and years ago. You can still get their die-cast model cars, and I think they do some plastic models, but it's all like cars and trucks and stuff like that. So this was nice to be able to find. Again, just because something's old doesn't mean it's no good. So here we go. Nice box art. Scale 1/72. This is molded in 3 colors. You'll see that in a moment. Most is molded in 1 color now, gray. But the reason I'm doing this kit is because if you've never built a model kit before and you're just starting out brand new, especially if you're a younger modeler, 8, 10, 12 years old, again, this would be a great kit to start with. For modelers under 12, you know, unless they've gained experience and they've developed knife skills and so on and so forth, I'd always recommend adult supervision. You're dealing with glue, which has quite deadly fumes. So you want to make sure you're in a well ventilated space with the windows open. It never hurts to have a little fan going to blow stuff away from you. Okay, so we'll start with the box here. Nice box art. Here we go. What Matchbox used to do is they had a 4-point scale, 4 being the most difficult or requiring the most skills. This is a 2. So you know, your average person should be able to do it. On the back, We got the paint schemes. And the PK116, that's the model number. You can tell, this is one way to tell that it's a genuine Matchbox kit, because all of their kits, they started with PK. It's the de Havilland Mosquito. A very famous aircraft from World War II. If you take a look at it, you know, it's pretty bad. It's pretty awesome. It was actually made of plywood and was powered by two Rolls-Royce Merlin engines, the same Merlin engine that went into the Spitfires. The aircraft saw action in many different theaters and in all sorts of different roles. It was a fighter, a night fighter, fighter bomber, straight bomber. It could actually carry up to 4,000 pounds of bombs, which was the same as the Flying Fortress at the time. And it was fast, over 400 miles an hour. It was durable too. I mean, it could take a beating. Plywood is tough. It's a two-seater. So let's open up the box and take a look here. No bag for the sprues and the decals. They might still be good. They look a little brown, yellowed and faded, but they feel pretty good. And they still have their, there you go. Still have the protective paper over top. At the time, these were inexpensive kits. And this is the way Matchbox did things back then. They had an orange series, which kind of had an orange background. But, you know, basically this is just a rendition, same as the box art. Aircraft notes. They've included, following the success of the Comet Racer and the Albatross airliner, de Havilland spent many months designing an unarmed bomber of wood construction. Eventually, specifications at 140 scale was drawn up and a prototype ordered by the Air Ministry. The contract finally being placed on 1st March 1940 for 50 bomber reconnaissance aircraft. Work was meanwhile progressing at great speed, and after only 11 months, the prototype flew on November 25th, 1940. Trials proceeded well, further machines were ordered, and 250 were delivered by September 1942, which is really fast production. And part of the reason for that was they were made of plywood. They weren't made of aluminum or other metal. Mosquitoes were used in all roles, bombers, fighters, night fighters, pathfinder reconnaissance, etc. They were able to carry a 4,000 pound bomb load to Berlin, and as I said, that was as large as the Flying Fortress could carry. Machines were also used as pathfinders to mark targets for artillery and bombs, and took part in many spectacular actions. Some 42 different versions were built, including machines fitted with a 6-pound 57mm gun. This aircraft was one of the most outstanding machines produced during World War II. It was fast, and you know, you can tell from the armament, it was deadly, and it really gave Luftwaffe pilots and the Nazi Germans fits, because it could get in, get out, and they could usually not even hardly touch it. Okay, So we've got that. We've got the details here, specifications. This is the Mark IX version. And as always, we should review the instructions. You get the legend, glue, don't glue. It'll mention if there's an alternate part you can use. And it says without a stand, add nose weight, whatever that means. On the back here, we've got the paint instructions. Now, these were all for Humbrol paint colors. Humbrols are still available. I used to use Humbrol paints all the time. They were considered the best back then. But some people aren't too crazy about them now. Testers is good for oil-based paints, enamels, and Vallejo paints are good for acrylic paints. You can buy paints individually, or you can buy them in a package, that are designed for weathering, specifically for military models with military colors, all sorts of different things. It shows you here what things to paint, what color, gives you the part numbers and so on and so forth. We're not going to paint this model. Certainly not on the inside. I might do the outside when we're done, but this video is going to be just about assembling it for an absolute beginner, how to do that. Review of the instructions doesn't take long, as we can see here. Just 12 steps altogether, and they're all just different sub-assemblies and so on and so forth. You can see the various symbols here, glue, optional part, don't glue for the propellers, so the propeller will turn. Not that that's a big deal, but in any case. Okay, so pretty straightforward stuff. I'm going to fold this back to get ready to work. But just before we start that, I'm going to go over the tools we're going to use. I've gone over this before. Some of these tools, the tweezers, emery board and Bright Boy, as well as the nippers, they came with a complete set, 38 pieces, from a company called Gundam, G-U-N-D-A-M. It's a Japanese company. They not only do tools, they also do models. But their models are all fantasy things like Godzilla and Transformers and things like that. But if you're into that, hey, take a look. I got this off of them. I got the kit, 38 pieces from Amazon, and it was about $50 plus tax when I got it, and it's still about the same. There's smaller ones that have less tools, so if you're just starting out, it might be a good idea. You don't need much, as you can see here. And a lot you probably already have around the house. So, but after you've done a couple of models and you find that you need more tools or you want more tools because your skill level is increasing, then certainly take a look at Gundam. All right, so here we go. We're going to need glue. We're going to use Mr. Cement Deluxe. You can use Tamiya glue. Testers makes glue, LePage's. The Testers and LePage's, that's usually in a tube and can be a little more difficult to work with. Tamiya also makes an extra thin cement. which we won't be using here because we won't need it. We'll probably use that on the Spitfire build. Okay, so we've got glue. Won't get very far without it. We've got the flat-sided nippers. These are actually, they were spring-loaded, but I've used them so much the spring broke. But they're inexpensive. Two types of tweezers, straight end and offset. X-Acto knife, one of these, well, not an X-Acto knife, but a hobby knife like this, came in the Gundam kit. Box cutter, I don't think I'll need it, but I always keep one handy. Emery board. You can use this to file your nails too. And this is kind of used like sandpaper to sand out bits and parts. And then this is what's often called a bright boy. And it's basically a pad. It's like a scouring pad. Has a rough surface, and that's very useful for some things. Has, you know, different different types of grit. So that's really handy too. Probably won't need it, but again, I put it aside. The other thing, I always have some toothpicks. These are really handy if you are if you're using the glue in the tube, because squirting it out of the tube and onto a little surface like this is messy. So it's best to, you know, squirt it out on a bit of paper and dip the toothpick in, and then you can run it along the line. Alright, so here we go with the actual kit. We've got the clear plastic parts. Yeah. There's a bit of scratch and a couple of flaws. But overall looks pretty good. It's a good reason for putting stuff in separate plastic bags. But again, back in the day, this was meant to be a very inexpensive kit for a junior modeler. So, all right. One thing we don't have here is this, an inventory of the sprues. Anyways, so we've got the clear ones. We've got gray for the fuselage, green for the wings, black for other accessory parts, the propellers, fuel tanks, and so forth. The detail for a kit this size isn't too bad. Very simple stuff. You get the two pilots. They would be a real challenge for me to paint, they're so small. So I'm just going to plunk them in there. With the canopy closed, you're not going to be able to see much of the cockpit anyway. Alright, so we won't need the clear parts for quite a while. And our first step here is the cockpit. And you'll notice when I use the nippers, I put the flat side toward the part. And this is so small, I'm going to use the knife. When you're cutting the small parts like that, always hold them down a bit because they can go pa-ching and fly off. And that's one of the drawbacks of using the glass pad here. Oh, that's the other thing that came with the Gundam kit, a nice pad for cutting and doing your models. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Alright, so yeah, one thing I'm not liking here is there's parts all over the place. The way that kits are usually done now is all the parts you're going to need for a specific assembly are going to be in the on the same sprue and usually in the same section. I guess because it's different colors, but especially since there's no sprue guide, I had to go hunting around for a bit. So here's what we're going to do. We'll finish off. Get the seats. And you got the base for the seats. So the pilots were on the green sprue, the seats and the base of the seat base were on the black sprue, and the yoke is on the green sprue. And you notice there, I scored it until it broke off. If I had tried to push it down and cut it that way, it would probably have broken. So, but now that this one's done, see if I can even get in here. There, with the nippers. Okay, and you always want to trim off any excess. Look for any sprue flash. That looks pretty good. Let's trim this. Okay, we'll trim these up and be right back. Okay, these are a little too bit delicate to trim, so I'm going to use the emery board. I'll file off the sprue nibs. You see what I mean? See how hard it would be to try and paint that little face and, you know, the straps and so on and so forth. I mean, you could do it, but you could also use a metal file to do this. There's a complete set of metal files, all different shapes, in the Gundam set. Now, as a general rule, you don't want to be moving the knife towards you, but when you're doing delicate paring like this, and again, you'll need adult supervision. You're not moving the knife quickly enough to damage yourself. Okay, so here we go. Usually when you glue, you want to glue both, or put cement on both surfaces that you're cementing. Blow on a little bit, let it dry just slightly. Set the figure. Make sure it's lined up and straight. And that one could be set aside for a moment to dry. And if you do get some glue on your hands or your fingers, go wash it off right away. I don't have it today, but I usually have a little cup of water. Because if it dries, you know, it's kind of nasty to get off. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. Number 5. And see how this works. Yeah. Okay. Here's the yoke. That's a piece you pull back and forth. Back for. Back for up. Down for down. I think. You want to use the least amount of glue possible. Because when it dries, it's it'll show up as white usually. Okay, both pilot figures are the same, so there's no need to figure out which is which. This little guy goes here, sits right down there. Oh, I should mention too, yeah, this aircraft was so powerful it required one pilot just to control the aircraft. They couldn't take their eyes off or their hands off for even a moment to do navigation or drop bombs or whatever the case may be. So that's why there's two here. One's the pilot, the other's the navigator bombardier. Alright, so that's done. Get set aside out of the way. Give it a few minutes to dry. Excuse me. Okay, next is going to be the fuselage. And the fuselage is another word for the body of the aircraft. Okay. So we've got the two pieces of the fuselage, and then there's the tail wheel. So we'll get these off the sprues and be right back. Alright, so here's another tip. Always cut either with a hobby knife or with your nippers. Don't twist stuff off the sprues. That's just a recipe for disaster. It can be hard enough to deal with stuff without having to deal with that. The other thing is, it might have been a good idea for this kit, although I don't usually do it. A lot of people like to take everything off the sprues right off the bat, before they even start the assembly. And that way, you know, they put them in separate cups or containers or whatever, and that way they have all the pieces together for the various different assemblies and sub-assemblies. Like I said, I don't usually do that, but it might have been a good idea with this kit because stuff is on different sprues. And so, here we go. Always run your finger along. You can feel the smoothness. One of our juvenile neighbors going by. Okay. There you go. Again, you want to triple check for flash and do a dry fit. Always do a dry fit. And that looks like it's going to go together perfectly. And again, good detail on this kit. You may not be able to see it, but you know, you can see the ridges of the tires. And fairly good rendition of the mechanism. So that'll go there like that. I'm not going to do it on this kit, but on larger kits, you can also file down a bit of the wheel, make it look a little flat so it actually looks like the weight of the aircraft is on it. Not going to do that for this though. Okay, so always try to apply your glue towards the inside. Now we'll see if we can get this to fit together without too much grief. And as I suspected, getting the pin in the other side is going to be tough. Just a moment, please. Okay, so we got that snapped in. I normally don't do this, but I think I will paint the outside. So I'm just going to put a bead of glue all the way along here. Everything's lined up nicely. There's a little hole there in the top, but that's for an antenna. There we go. There's the main fuselage. Alright, oh, here's another little tip. I use these little plastic clothespins. You can use elastic bands. But we'll just set this aside and let it dry. Okay, so now we see here. We're going to move on. We're going to start with some of the clear parts. put the nose goes on. This is what they call it, talk about the optional parts. This is you can see them here, these little bubbles. They were like so the pilot could kind of put his head out, tilt his head over, and kind of see out a little farther. And they might also have been magnified, I'm not sure about that. But, and yeah, here we've got optional parts. We've got just the regular canopy here. And we've also got canopy with a bubble on it. That's called the, I think it's called the astro bubble, actually. So that they could look up, see the stars for navigation. And then these little guys would go on the side. I'm going to use this one, but this is going to go on last because I'm going to paint the exterior of the model. So we'll leave that aside for now. And that just leaves the nose. Again, there's optional parts. So these optional parts, this would be the regular one for the fighter, bomber, and so forth. And this one here, which has a plastic piece that goes on the end, there it is there. That would be for reconnaissance. They'd put cameras in the nose. And then they would fly over whatever they were flying over and take the pictures. So, not going to throw those away. You never know when they might come in handy. Worst come to worst, you could always practice painting. Alright, so we'll get these off the sprues. This is pretty straightforward. One. Your fingers away from the nippers too. Go. And we'll clean these up a little bit. Smooth out the cut marks. And again, we dry fit. Let's see, there's a little bit of stuff here. A little bit of flash there. And I don't know if you can see it. I also, you know, the numbers are number. Numbers for parts like this are on the sprues. But for parts like this, they're actually molded in. Okay, nice dry fit. Just hold that for a moment or two. Retrieve our fuselage. And this shows the gap here going up. And do another dry fit. Everything looks good there. Okay. Let it dry just a little bit. Bit more of a seam there than I'd like, but we'll be able to deal with that. And to make double sure, I'm gonna go inside here. Oops, you know what I forgot to do? Bad Steve. I forgot to put in our pilots. Fortunately, they just slip right in there. Glue's getting a little low, it's getting difficult to There we go. And another reason you don't want to use too much cement is because this type of cement and plastic, it actually melts the plastic. So if you get too much, then you know you get this kind of melted effect that you either have to sand out. Just painting over it usually won't work. Okay. Looks like that can come off. I don't know if you can see a bit of a seam there. Here's okay because this is the rudder and it needs to move back and forth. But I'll have to, before I paint, I'll have to take a bit of putty, excuse me, modeling putty and fix that. There isn't one on this side because the joint's on this side. Okay. So, there we go. We've got our fuselage. Having optional parts is great too, because especially for the clear plastic ones, if you screw it up and get glue on it, then it makes a mess. Alright, so I don't know, you can probably, yeah, you can see just there, you can see that how it's, the glue has dried. And like I said, that's not going to matter because I'm going to paint this anyways after. Okay, so we're moving on. By now you've seen how to cut the parts off the sprue. You don't need my help. There we go. Okay, so these are the rear stabilizers. Alright, the flappy things go at the back. Again, we're going to do dry fit. Dry fit. Okay. It's a bit weird having it in three colors, but that's the way they did it. You know, paints are expensive today, but you know, back then, especially if you were a kid, you know, your allowance probably wouldn't allow for much, if any, paint. So, alright, so those look to go on pretty well. They're not flopping, flapping down. Uh, Alright, so this was kind of, you know, it went 1, 2, 3, 4, and then back to here. So anyways, we used option number 3, just glue the two together. Option 4 for the observation photographic reconnaissance. There's a little bit more detail. Okay, so now we're going to move to number 7. All right, so now we're getting down to the wheel assembly. And looks like we bent apart. Oh no. Easily straightened, very gently. There we go. Alright. Another tip as well, and this goes for both carpentry and sewing, is measure twice, cut once. So before you do your cut, you want to make sure you're cutting in the right place and you're not cutting too much stuff off. Okay, we'll glue the wheels together. Okay, so we got the wheels off the sprues and glued together, and these pieces go on. Okay, and another tricky little bit here. Alright, so yeah, you'll see here on the legend, 46 and 47. You don't glue those here. You glue these together, obviously, but you don't glue these to 43 and 45. And you glue these ones. So it explains to you how to do that. Alright, so I took the parts off for the next sub-assembly and got everything trimmed up. Another thing, I usually put a little cup nearby for bits of sprue and little bits you've trimmed off. That way they're not all over your work surface. As well, I should have said at the beginning, as you can see here, I've laid out newspaper and put my cutting surface on top of it in case anything spills or whatever. It's not going to wreck the tabletop surface. Okay, so we're going to put the nacelles together now. Again, we'll do a dry fit. Everything looks okay. So, here we go. Alright, and the other thing I noticed too is that the plastic seems to be pretty soft here. So that's not from age. It just would have been the quality of the plastic they used back then. Some of the parts are quite good. Others, it's pretty soft. So I guess it depends. Excuse me. Alright, so here's where we're at. So, again, we've got optional parts. These are the exhaust pipes. You can see there. And they would have been covered in the, particularly in the night fighter version, and also for aircraft used for night reconnaissance. Obviously, you got flames spitting out the side, it's easy to see your aircraft. So I'm going to put these on instead of covering them. And here we go. I'm going to start with the propeller assembly. That goes there, and this goes here, and it says don't glue these parts, otherwise the propeller won't turn. Not a big deal, but hey. Okay, and then this is called the spinner. Sometimes I call it the nose cone, but it's technically not a nose cone. Wanting to cooperate. All right. So the propeller gets glued to the spinner. And these two parts do not get glued. Okay, so the whole assembly of the spinner and the propeller, that will all spin at the same time. Okay. Excuse me. Okay, the exhaust pipes go down and back. And the Tamiya extra thin cement, it has a really tiny brush as well. Last one. This one's a bit large for this particular bit, but we're going to paint it anyway, so glue marks don't matter. Alright, so here we go. Just going to do one of these and then take a break for the day. We'll finish up with part two. Okay, so there's nacelle number one. And propeller number one. And that's not cooperating. So, good place to stop for today. And I'll be back next time. And we'll finish these nacelles and complete the build.